not waste any time. Let's get started. I'm here with Roger Joseph Manning Jr. from Music Survival Guide. Got him on the line from California to New York. Hello, Roger.
Hey there. Hi, everybody.
So, really hard for me to kind of find a starting point to do this. First, 1,000 thank yous for doing it. I kind of started a bit of a theme here. I've decided to call what will be the finished piece the Roger Joseph Manning Jr. Variety Show. So let's start from now and take a bit of a trip through the past, if you will. I know you've got another solo record on the way. That's very exciting. Can you tell us a bit about it?
Well, let's see. If the listener is familiar with the first two at all, it's kind of in keeping with that. I just explore my favorite styles from the 60s and 70s primarily, and some songs are very guitar heavy, and others are very keyboard heavy, and lots of different feels and grooves, and I just like kind of getting it out of my system. Some of the songs are, I would say all the songs generated from ideas that were either written right around the Jellyfish days or Imperial Drag days. So,
wow.
They're unfinished ideas that I had lying around that I still have a lot of faith in, and testing them off and completing them. Lyrics take me a while.
Uh-huh.
I had the privilege of working with two great lyricists in the past. And,
right.
I have fun doing the lyrics myself, but I'm not particularly fast at it. So it can slow down the process. And, the record's been in works for well over 2 years now, and that's only because I've been busy traveling with Beck and doing session work. And,
right.
You know,
that's amazing. So, it's your third solo record, and I think we kind of touched on a little bit just moments ago here, but can you compare it to its predecessors, Catnip Dynamite and Solid State Warrior, a.k.a. The Land of Pure Imagination?
Yeah, I mean, you could actually think of it as the third in that series. There's not anything that's going to surprise the listener as far as what I'm going for.
Right.
More songs with all of the standards and values that I look for in quality songwriting that I'm attempting to live up to with my own pieces. And the only thing different is that there are more guest players.
Nice.
I played a lot of guitar on this record.
Cool.
Victor Andrizzo plays drums. And,
wow.
Steve McDonald plays some bass. My brother Chris has been helping me record vocals.
That's awesome.
And really, he's been a godsend because he's kind of, he's been a great set of ears to kind of help produce the vocals with me.
Cool, that's exciting.
I've tried to do all this in the past by myself.
Right.
And I just wanted to try to get some fresh ears into the process with all of the wonderful musical friends I have.
Yeah, that's beautiful. It sounds very exciting. So the first two have had a few different types of releases domestically and overseas. What are your plans for this one?
My plans for this one are also different in that I want to release it and do a fan funding record.
Okay.
So when time is right, when I start nearing completion, I'll probably launch a big campaign on pledgemusic.com.
Okay, right. Yeah, that's common nowadays. It's cool. It's a fun thing.
Yeah. I've had great conversations with the people over there. I have friends who've had great success with that forum, and I'm going to be exploring it myself. So, unlike the other two records, I'll be offering incentives and
cool.
All kinds. I'm still trying to figure out what those are, but I can basically say there will probably be some unearthed jellyfish paraphernalia.
Uh-oh.
Rarities from my first two solo records, and a lot of one-of-a-kind items that might interest bands.
Awesome. Cool. So you also cut a kind of mostly electronic type record a few years ago under the name Malibu. Was that a one-time thing, or can we expect more from that?
Yeah, that was a one-time thing. Well, I'd love to do another one. I just don't really have the time.
Right. Okay.
It's always a dance between working on musical projects that I enjoy, that pay my bills, and sure. ones that I enjoy that, you know, don't really have an income attached to them. And so,
right.
it's just a juggling act like anybody has to do. So, usually the stuff that isn't going to necessarily generate an income flow, you know.
Right. Just pet projects.
It keeps getting shoved to the side.
Right. No, I definitely can understand that. So, what was it like recently to be a part of Beck's Grammy-winning record there, Morning Phase?
Well, it was absolutely incredible.
Right.
It was the first album I'm aware of that I've had a big hand in, that received, you know, that recognition. And it's really more than that, though. It's a kind of a culmination of the history of my involvement with Beck and that group of musicians. We all kind of started together in 1997. That's when I joined him and that group of people, and played with them, toured with them, recorded with them off and on since that time. And
right.
there was a period in the 2000s where I really was not involved with him simply because I wanted to stay home and do original music and do remixes and session work. I wanted to work on records. You're out on the road so much, very often that can't.
It's hard.
You're in hotel rooms, you're not in recording studios.
Right.
So for most of the 2000s, I didn't have any direct involvement with him, even though we stayed in touch. And in 2011, he surprised all of us and invited us all kind of back into the fold.
Mm-hmm.
And we all, you know, jumped at the idea, working on this new record, touring it. That was 5 years ago. But yeah, it was such an ultimate surprise and honor to get those awards, and it just felt really good after years of being pop rock world here in Los Angeles, and there's certainly albums I've played on and gone gold and platinum, but I don't think there's been any direct, at least not any Grammys of that caliber.
Right. Yeah, that was huge. Cool. So yeah, you kind of answered my next question, was kind of how did you start working with Beck? So we'll pass by that one. We'll cut to your buddy and former bandmate there, Jason Faulkner, also played a part in that. Let's kind of touch on him for a bit. It started back in Jellyfish after many years went by before you actually would work with Jason again. I know there's a lot of history there, but can you tell us a little bit about Jason? Maybe a beginning, middle, and end, perhaps?
As far as what, my history with him, or my history with him and Beck, or?
Whatever you like. I mean, it's a long, long relationship there, so maybe just a little something about the JF man there.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, it's very odd because I met Jason when he was barely 18.
Right.
I answered an ad in the paper that he had down here in Los Angeles. I was still in college. And, we didn't decide to work together at that time, but we felt a deep connection, like, instantly. As everybody knows, we invited him to participate in Jellyfish, and that was a fantastic experience.
Right.
That only ended because Andy and I weren't interested in sharing the writing scenario. We just had so many songs, and Jason wanted to continue to branch out and write and sing his own song.
Right.
So it was very clear, you know, cutting the chase, it was very clear he needed to pursue solo stuff, which he did. So, unfortunately, we couldn't keep that together, but it made sense for him to go his own way and pursue his amazing solo career that he had.
Yeah.
And, but along the way, not only had he and I teamed up on Beck, but we had a short-lived Project TBIs, which was both of us and our drummer friend Brian Reitzel.
Right, which I have in here too, yeah.
Yeah, and, that was a wonderful experience because it was, you know, in a lot of ways it was like, let's try to do all the things we couldn't make work in Jellyfish work in this group.
Cool. Mm-hmm.
Which we did, because it was very much an equal writing partnership.
Right.
Jason did the thing with vocals and But it was very much a trio effort in how it was all put together. So it was a lot of fun for us. And unfortunately, we couldn't manage to get any kind of record company interest at the time.
Right.
That was before a lot of bands were doing. Because yeah, that TVI definitely had an 80s influence.
Yeah, no, it was awesome. I love that stuff.
Cool, thank you. And but, you know, that was very, in 2000, 2001, again, nobody was really doing that stuff. So
right.
A lot of record companies were confused, and they didn't know what to make of us, and so ultimately they didn't sign us. So, we did that for a good 3 years, giving up the old college try, so to speak, and then I continue to do freelance. I've played on recording sessions with Jason, but mostly it's been through our involvement with Beck, where we've reconnected and really had some really great quality hangout time as, you know, much more mature, easygoing music makers than we were as the desperate, young, hungry, jellyfish guys.
Right, no, for yeah. Sure. Yeah.
It's been great to connect with him in our 40s, you know?
Right, no, that's awesome. It seems like you guys have definitely relit that flame. Before I even get into TVIs, I know you guys did stuff with Cheap Trick. You kind of opened for them, you and Jason, a few years ago, and doubled up as kind of like extra members of the band. You guys performed a few of each other's solo stuff. You did Jellyfish stuff. That was a major deal for Jellyfish people. When did you guys decide to do that, and how did it feel kind of putting that back together and revisiting that stuff?
Well, we were just at the right place at the right time in that we're working with a producer named Julian Raymond who thought it would be great. And Howard Willing is an engineer who also had a very big hand in making that Cheap Trick record.
Mm.
They had both worked with Jason and I and thought it would be great for us to contribute to the album. That went very smoothly, and the success of that led the producer to suggest a Cheap Trick that they have me and Jason out to help really flesh out the band and just kind of make it extra fancy or special in them debuting the new record. Fortunately, they agreed. Lucky
yeah.
For us.
Amazing. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so it was already amazing enough to play shows with them. But then to have them say, hey, on these handful of special engagements, would you guys like to open up the shows, you know? And just, you know, perform some Jellyfish songs and some solo songs. It was just incredible music to say. So I look back on that and in awe and just amazed that it actually all came to fruition.
Yeah, no, that must have been awesome. I know you're a big Cheap Trick person, so that was cool.
Absolutely.
Very nice to see that. So, I mean, I know we touched a bit on TVIs and kind of rebuilding and building your relationship again with Jason and working with Brian from Air. Anything else on the TVIs tip, or is that kind of on the back burner for now, too?
It's all, you know, it's no different than Malibu.
Or right. Okay.
There's no time, and I wanted to do another new cookbook record, too.
Right.
You wake up in the morning and you got to prioritize, as we all do, I simply have not found a way to be that prolific with my projects.
Mm.
I don't know how Todd Rundgren does it. But, so that's the deal there. Brian's very busy and a very successful film score.
Right.
Jason does more and more production these days. So everybody's busy and happily so, doing stuff they want to do. Keeping their standard of living and TVIs is unfortunately something I'm sure we'd all want to do it. It's just none of us have the extra time. And people start families.
Right, of course.
Yep. The old story.
Yeah. Makes sense. So let's hop back a bit in time here to the mid-90s when you put out a phenomenal record with a band called Imperial Drag. Some people even say that it might be your greatest work. It even included Mr. Eric Dover on lead vocals and guitar there. Him also being a former Jellyfish member coming on board to help you guys support Spilt Milk. When did you know that you wanted to work with Eric in the form of a front man after kind of him being a touring member of Jellyfish?
A few months after Jellyfish disbanded, Eric and I continued, and Tim Smith, we all continued to stay in touch and swap demo tapes of music we were all working on. And Tim and Eric and I were all talking about working on a project, but Tim was on a place, in a place in his life where it was very difficult for him to drop his family responsibilities and come out to California
right.
to work with us. Eric had no family responsibilities, and he was more free in that respect, and moved out and literally stayed on a friend's couch and guest bedroom in Los Angeles so we could try to work together to see what it might yield. And so it naturally evolved that way, and Eric and I tried lots of different things and approaches, and Eric Dover, I caught him at a time where he was just blossoming as a songwriter.
Right.
It was very easy to kind of pick up my collaborative process that I had with Andy with Eric Dover. He was a guy who sang fantastic, enjoyed writing lyrics, and had plenty of good song ideas.
Cool.
So we just kind of jumped in and found some other guys who were into helping us out, and fortunately kept the record company interest along the way.
Right. No, that's cool. I mean, Eric's an animal. He's a huge personality, and his voice is out of control. I have a feeling the answer to this one's going to be similar to TVI's in Malibu. What would there ever be another go-round with Imperial Drag? Did you ever think about that?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, you know, same reason.
Right.
But we've got a 4-CD package. We're trying to get off the ground with a local record company called Omnivore.
Right.
The issue with the Jellyfish album.
Yeah, they've been doing a lot. Yeah, Omnivore's cool.
And they want to do it, but apparently there are some challenges with licensing the Imperial Drag songs contractually. So because it's been challenging, they just haven't bothered to put it as a priority. So we still talk about it, but they haven't made it a priority. And so, you know, I actually owe them a phone call. to see if they want to continue to pursue it, because
cool.
it'd be a pretty neat package. There are so many demos that we did.
Yeah, I know they floated around for a while. It would be cool to see that out in some sort of fashion other than like a bootleg way, you know?
Right, absolutely.
So even in between and after Jellyfish and Imperial Drag, you concocted like a few records with your keyboard-centric experiment duo there, the Moog or Moog Cookbook. You guys did mostly covers with that, really fun, weird stuff. And you took on the bit of the alter ego. The Mecco Eno was you, right?
Yes.
Okay, and how did you ever come up with that? I mean, I know you got a lot floating around in that brain.
How did Moog Cookbook happen?
Yeah, I mean, just that kind of whole spacey, weird persona thing. It was so much fun.
Yeah, that was a very therapeutic project for me in that Jellyfish had broken up. I was pretty worn out and saddened by that.
Right.
Imperial Drag had not started yet, but even when it did start, that was a very challenging, work-intensive project from the get-go. So Moog Cookbook kind of became an outlet for me, because what happened was I met my partner, Brian Kehew. We were buying and swapping old gear together, and we had a similar taste for the old synthesizer world. And Brian and I became instant friends. We became collector friends together. We just hang out together. He became one of my best friends in Los Angeles, because I barely moved to LA. I'd barely been there about a year. We were frustrated that at the height of grunge, nobody was interested in any keyboards, really.
Right.
Popular music was guitar driven, which we had no problem with. We liked plenty of that music. I mean, you know, Imperial Drag was guitar based, even though I added a lot of keyboards to it. But we would talk to people about these instruments, and nobody wanted to know about them. They just thought they were silly, they didn't want them on their records, or they weren't interested. And which, on the one hand, was great, because they were very affordable to collect. It didn't cost much money at all.
Right.
And on the other hand, our rooms were filled with these dusty keyboards that weren't getting used. And I started to use them a bit in Imperial Drag, but not really what that band was about. So Brian and I decided to do our own music for fun and amusement, literally comedy records to make ourselves and our friends laugh. a lot of inside musical jokes. And we decided to model them after the Switched On records of the 60s, where when the Moog synthesizer had just come out, it became very fashionable to have albums with just the Moog synthesizer that would cover whatever the current hit parade was on radio. So lots of Moog plays the hits of the Beatles, or plays the hits of Burt Bacharach, or a variety of songs. And those records are just some of my most favorites to collect and listen to. And so we modeled our stuff after that. That's why the Moog Cookbook records are both all covers. We did very few original pieces and some remixes. But they're also very humorous.
They're definitely fun. I mean, I definitely share some laughs when I play that stuff for people. They're like, what is going on? It's fun.
And we derived so much pleasure out of just doing a few of those songs inside of doing album's work and actually see if we could get it released, which we did.
Right.
On an independent label that was fairly, they've been around for a while, so they had some reach. So our CD kind of got sprinkled around the U.S. It got sprinkled in England and in France, Japan. And much to our surprise, got way more of a response than we ever thought, including the biggest response and most important response, which was the band Air, reached out to us to do a remix of one of their songs. And they were just starting to get lots of attention in England and the U.S. The timing couldn't have been better.
Right, cool. That's amazing.
And that's how we got introduced to Air. They reached out to us, and then they were in Los Angeles on business. They were actually visiting Beck because they were friends with Beck, and he had just done a remix for them. And I had just joined Beck, so all this stuff was happening within months.
Right, that's cool.
And we said, well, how come you guys don't tour? And they said, well, we don't have a band. Well, why not? We can't find anybody in Paris. I said, wait a minute, you live in one of the most major cities in the world. Clearly there are musicians who you can find to play with to be your backup. They said, no, we hate them all. So we were like, okay, that's kind of crazy, but, you know, hey, what if we went out as four crazy keyboard players, and Brian and I, what if the Moog Cookbook was your backup? And they said, wow, that's a great idea, but don't we need drums, and don't we need bass? And so, almost within the next 24 hours, we invited Justin from Beck's band to play bass. We reached out to Brian Reitzel, who was playing the Red Cross at the time, to be our drummer.
Cool.
And that's how Brian got introduced to Air.
Yeah, cool. I see how that came together. That's a lot of stuff in a short time.
Yeah, we had a band almost instantly, and they couldn't have been more excited. They'd never played their music live. They came to Los Angeles, we rehearsed, and so we toured the Air records in 1998 and recorded the next album with them in 99. And just lots of really fun, eventful things happening at that time.
Cool. All right, so now I know I know that you know that this is coming now. Let's take a bit of a step back again and spend some time in the world known as Jellyfish. I'd ask you if you ever got sick of hearing about this stuff, but my personal opinion nowadays, it's like Jellyfish is bigger than ever to me. What do you think about this?
Well, certainly people continue to talk about it.
It's crazy. I mean, ever since I was a little kid, Jellyfish has been in my life. And to see now what's happening, it's like, whoa. You know, I've been there the entire time. It's really amazing. Yeah, it's beautiful. I love it. Because I'm still obsessed, Roger. I can't lie to you. I am, there is not a band I collect more. You know what I mean? I'm still spreading it to everybody. It's just a big piece of my heart, Jellyfish.
Well, I can't receive a bigger compliment than that. And so thank you for that.
Thank you.
Anybody who's listening who shares your passion. It means the world to me that to this day those records continue to affect people and continue to gain new fans here and there. I can remember being in college and the band Big Star was having a big resurgence and people were reissuing their CD. And my generation, my college friends, discovered Big Star. Mid to late 80s. And it was a great journey. They had, barely three records. And it was about know, almost 15, 20 years after the fact. You know, to see a similar thing happening with Jellyfish has just been so flattering and filled me with such joy. Because that's what you want. I mean, you don't want those records to just affect people with 10 years they come out.
Right.
Because the whole point, what Andy and I were trying to do, and what I think we did do, was continue in the tradition of our influences. We wanted to make classic rock pop music. It didn't matter that it was coming out in the early 90s. We wanted it to carry on in that tradition. We wanted the hooks, lyrics, and everything to be timeless about it. That's why we didn't follow any trends of the day.
Right.
And, you know, so far so good. It looks like that's kind of what's happened.
Yeah, definitely so far so good, for sure.
So that's, you know,
yeah.
I'm enjoying my life to see that happen.
No, that's cool. And I mean, I tried to really think of some original questions here that you might not have heard, but there's a ton of stuff I'm sure that you've answered 100 times or maybe even answered just a few times. But there is a Jellyfish book coming out now. Is that totally crazy to you? What's that about?
No, I've been involved. We've all been involved in it.
Right.
In fact, I'm editing. We're not editing, I should say. I'm giving my comments to the author on several chapters as we speak.
Cool. Yeah, I know it's close.
And, well, you know, I mean, it'll be good for the fans. I think he's doing a good job on the book. There's a lot of wonderful, interesting behind-the-scenes trivia in there. But, you know, for all the joy, it's quite a sad story in that, as musicians, we made some incredible art together, in my humble opinion, of course.
Yes.
But as people, we had a lot to learn about getting along and compromising and doing all those things to keep a band family together.
Right.
And we were very young and immature and suffered from all of us could have had better people skills. Could have had better group working skills. And I think anybody who picks up the book will see that. But there's not really any great mystery to why the band dissolved. It was kind of going to happen anyway because we had a lot to learn as four people in relationships. You know, the joke is always that a band is not two people married, it's four people married,
yeah.
You know, or more. And there was no handbook for that. Well, there wasn't band counseling per se, and so we lived and learned, and the challenges of holding our relationships together eventually is what was the demise of the band. And, of course, there were some musical issues too, but so, you know, that stuff's talked about, and it's been both joyful and challenging, needless to say, to relive some of those experiences because they were so long ago now, over 20 years.
Right. Well, I mean, I'm definitely, I mean, there's a lot of people that are definitely excited to read it. I'm not sure exactly what all the content is in there. I'm sure it's pretty vast. But was there ever a third Jellyfish record ever being planned?
No, because we didn't have the material.
Okay.
It never got that far. We didn't stay together long enough to start working on, you know, Imperial Drag stayed together long enough to have material for a whole second record.
Right.
And we broke up during the recording of that second record.
Okay.
That was not the case with Jellyfish. We broke up pretty much right after Spilt Milk touring finished.
Okay. Alright. I know some years ago you mentioned you had communicated with Andy via email after many years of silence. Was that sort of the start of something, or was that like the big period on a really long sentence you've kind of been waiting for so many years?
Yeah, I would say it's more of a period. And that email has certainly, the past few years have been sprinkled with communication between he and I. But it's been very... It's pretty much only been due to business issues that needed to be taken care of with random minimal stuff that came up with Jellyfish catalog that we needed to talk about. I'm just happy that, you know, it's very clear that Andy and I, for all intents and purposes, have made amends, and that's a good feeling. I think both of us know that we want to reach out any further via email. We're free to do that, as opposed to any, you know, there's no apprehension.
Right, okay.
But as far as any desire to pursue any more Jellyfish music, that just simply hasn't been talked about. I think everybody's just going 100 miles an hour in their own respective careers. From what I understand, Andy's very successful scoring children's shows on Disney Network.
Right.
Probably other things I'm not aware of. And so it just had to come up in conversation.
Right. Okay. Yeah. I mean, I was going to ask what kind of relationship do you have with him now, but it sounds just like a few sparse emails here and there.
Yeah, it's been very peripheral. It's not really a relationship to speak of. And I think if there's such a time that he and I want that, we will create that.
Right.
But like I said, we've just been going 1,000 miles an hour in our respective lives, and we've been fine with that.
Yeah, I mean, I know you guys had been together for a long time, from college to Beatnik Beach, which ultimately led to Jellyfish.
Well, no, I've known Andy since high school.
Since high school, okay. So even before college, right? Okay.
In fact, the book is a really kind of colorful, just linear history.
Nice.
It's, it's fun, I know, for myself to read about, Andy Partridge and Colin Moulding from XTC being school chums and how they forged the nucleus of that band. It was always fun for me to read all the trivia, behind the scenes, incidental stuff.
Right. Cool.
And
yeah.
XTC fans wouldn't care. But I did because I was so into that group. So,
right. I know you had mentioned earlier that, you were very kind of in a sad spot, I guess, when Jellyfish came to an end. I would say, how did you feel now? I mean, were you upset, or was it kind of like happy to start a new chapter? Was it a little bit of both at the time? Or?
A little bit of both. I mean, I definitely needed some space from everything with Jellyfish, and that space turned into logical. It seemed like, this project, everybody concerned is probably going to be better off if we just end things here, kind of thing. So,
right.
Yeah, of course it was sad. Any relationship that breaks up, even if it's healthy for that relationship, it's the people to move on. Certainly we know divorced couples that are better off having moved on, but there's so much connection, deep connection, emotional ties with these people. You shared so much life and so many important moments of your lives together. But yeah, but there's a sadness, a sentimental, just sorrow around the whole thing. And of course, yeah, so it was, that's the best way to describe it. I mean, you can always, it's the only way you can go back and say, well, what if you did it differently? Or what if the band had gone to band counseling, or
right.
Try to make a third record, or what if Jason didn't want to pursue a solo career, or whatever it may be, and that's all, then we would be talking about that right now.
Sure.
The fact is, we all chose a different path, and those different paths have been filled with all kinds of stuff, and have been fulfilling and exciting, and so that's what we're talking about instead. So it's not a right or wrong, it's all learning. I've learned
for
so much from who I was in the Jellyfish band, because I own, and as you'll see from the book, I own all of my choices that didn't serve the band very well. Mistakes, if you will, but actually I don't believe in mistakes. I just believe, that didn't serve me or the guys, so next time I'm going to choose something different.
Right.
And you keep trying to make better, more loving choices for yourself and the community you're with, whether that's your significant other or your four significant others in a band, your co-workers, and we're always in relationships. A band is a relationship like anything else.
Yeah.
I learned many, many things from the choices that I made in that group that didn't ultimately serve. And guess what? I don't make those choices anymore. I make better ones that have better results. Like I said, so, you know, are greater good to everybody concerned. And that can only happen from living life.
For sure. Yes, words to live by, for sure. Now, based on all the Jellyfish stuff that has been released since the breakup, is there, like, any hidden secret nugget anywhere that anyone could expect to ever hear? Or is everything pretty much out there? Yeah, anything. Musically, demo, anything, you know?
No, not that I know.
Okay.
I mean, the last drip, trickle from the
faucet
was the Harry Nilsson tribute.
Right, okay.
Which was just Andy and I covering Think About Your Troubles, and, so, yeah.
Right. So, I mean, you kind of answered this one too already. I know you've worked with all the guys in some way, shape, or form since the breakup, really, except for Andy. Would there ever be, excuse me, a possibility of a Jellyfish reunion, or you can't really even answer that, right?
I'm never going to say never.
Okay, well, it's...
certainly people have approached this.
Yes, I know.
Seriousness.
Right.
And I think that, you know, what you're talking about is that has to be a unanimous decision. So you can't have two of the four people going, wow, I really want to do this.
No, of course.
Have to wake up one day and go, this would be the coolest, healthiest, most fulfilling thing. And then we all talk about it. We have that discussion and it happens. And again, you know, I think everybody's just been moving so full steam ahead in their own respective careers,
sure,
and personal lives, that, you know, certainly everybody's probably thought about it at one time or another, but nobody's acted on it because we're just busy doing other things.
Right. So we're almost done, Roger. Thanks. Out of all your projects,
I'm having a good time.
All right, cool. Thank you. Could you pick maybe like a top three of your favorite of your projects, you know, out of everything? Is there three that you could say, like, these three I absolutely say are my favorite ones? If I could put you on the spot.
Well, fortunately, I don't have any regrets with any of them. You know, that's the thing. Every project I've ever been involved with, Jellyfish related or not, has been, you know, even when I do session work, even if I work for some band for one day, you know, or I work repeatedly with a band like Blink 182, or I played on like four of their records, and, you know, you either commit and you put your heart and all of your skills that you have at that time in your life into it, or you don't.
Right.
Because you're not going, whatever the product yields, is not going to be worth if you haven't committed and poured your heart into it. But after you've done that, you can walk away from it and go, I did my best. I gave the world, and this project specifically, everything I was capable of giving. Now it's up to the fans.
Right.
And so, even to this day, I don't look back on anything I did with Jellyfish or Imperial Drag or World Cookbook and say, wow, I would have really left that song off the record, or I would have completely rearranged. Sure, there's little tidbits here and there that you go, yeah, I wonder if we'd done that, what it would sound like. But I have no regrets, and
well, that's a great thing.
And music was something that we had experience with and were skilled at, but making a video wasn't.
Right, for sure.
You know, or doing a photo shoot, that whole world was very new. A lot of first timers for me and my bandmates in Jellyfish days, of course, in particular, and so you live and learn. There's certainly things I would have done differently with photo shoots or videos, but I think it's all fun, and we were just going for it, and really trying to make a difference in a world that, to this day, I think is very predictable. Very prefab, very calculated.
Right, for sure.
Geared towards the lowest common denominator, all those things. And we wanted to do something very few artists have ever had success with, which was venture into the pop arena to have success on our own terms. And interestingly enough, I have the privilege of supporting one of the few artists in the last 40 years who's done that. For so long to such a degree, which is Beck.
Right.
And how he has surfed the pop rock, you know, hip-hop world.
Yeah.
And done pretty well for himself, gained a pretty large following, sold quite a few albums, toured the world extensively. But it's completely been on his own terms.
Mm-hmm.
You can't say he's influenced by anybody, or he sounds like anybody. And so it's been, you know, not a surprise that I was attracted to him and his world, and fortunately, he enjoys my contributions. And so it's been really great, all the projects I've done. It's like, look, we're going to give you sing-along hooks and quality production, and what you guys decide to do with it is your call, but this is what we know how to do, and I think we do it as good as anybody in history. Check it out. And I've been very blessed. A lot of record companies and different artists have given me and my bandmates a forum to do that. And, you know, I've been able to provide a living for myself through music. Do I live in a mansion in the Hollywood Hills with a private recording studio and a pool and whatever else you want to attach to that? No. But that's not important to me.
Right.
And the only reason I wish any of my projects would have sold more is because that would have meant more people heard them.
Of course.
So, because I want, you know, in any of these projects, it was always about, look, we're throwing a very special, unique, fun party. Not for everybody, but we think a lot of you are going to like it. And I wish more people had either been exposed to that party, or taken a liking to it, and, you know, but that's not the case. Like I said, we started this conversation talking about the Jellyfish legacy and how it still has impact for a certain community.
Yeah.
2016.
It sure does.
It's a beautiful, beautiful thing.
Yeah, I love it. I mean, it's
that I don't take for granted.
Mm. Yeah, no, it is beautiful. So this one might be easier. How about like three favorite records that you've done? Can you pin those down? Like that you've done though, not with Beck. Not, I mean, I'm talking like straight up Roger projects, Jellyfish, Imperial Drag, TV Eyes.
Right, something I've had direct kind of collaborative involvement in. Gosh, well, if you want three, probably the Catnip Dynamite.
Okay.
Spilled Milk.
Okay.
Well, and then probably the TV Eyes record.
Okay, cool.
I really like what happened on that album. I think the writing on that record is so, so strong. And I'm happy to say it was a very collaborative process between me and the guys. And I just think we really churned out some 3-4 minute, you know, 80s pop hits.
yeah.
You know, in a modern production setting. And I think those three records also really just kind of show my scope of what I've tried to offer so far.
Yes, it is very vast, for sure. So let's maybe circle back to the beginning real quick. The new solo record, a title, release date, any first-time insider info you'd like to share here?
No title yet.
Okay.
I mean, I've got a ways to go on it, of course.
Okay.
At this point, all the guests have pretty much made their appearance, and so I'm fleshing out all the vocals, which take me a very, very long time to do.
Right, I can imagine.
And then there's instrument detailing. I haven't even thought about the fun things like album art, album title.
All right, so you're still...
All that stuff.
Right, okay, so it's still kind of early then.
You know, nobody's more bummed about that than me.
Right.
Every time I open up the computer and start working away on it, especially if it's been like 3 weeks since I last worked on it or whatever, I go, oh my God, I can hear the finish line. I can hear that this idea here is really, really solid. I just have a little ways to go, and I can hear that this idea over here is going to be good, but I've got a much longer way to go on this one.
Right.
And, you know, I get very hopeful, and all I need is time.
For sure.
And I'll figure it out, but gosh, I don't know. Might be 6 months or more out of the way. You know, Beck's getting geared up for some summer touring.
Okay.
That usually means I don't get to work on the record at all. So,
right. No, for sure.
That's fine. I love touring with him.
Yeah, no, that's great. I was going to ask, are there any shows or like a band lineup ready to support the record, but that's probably also to be determined, right?
Oh, yeah. I don't even know if I'm going to have the time or desire to play live shows for the new record. Right. I mean, I really only ever did in Japan anyway.
Right, right. I remember that.
And I don't currently have a Japanese album deal. It was for the first two records. So, just gotta see. I'm very excited about putting it out and
funding it. Yeah, cool. Yeah, that'll be awesome. I can't wait to see what you cook up for those, you know, incentives. Now, I know we could probably spend an eon talking about this stuff. I know you're a gear guy. You've got tons of trinkets. Is there a favorite piece that you have?
Wow.
Yeah, that's another tough one, I know.
Oh, well, yeah, they all do a little something special, right? One of the funnest instruments to play, but I seem to put on almost everything unless I'm working on somebody else's record and they just don't have an interest in it. So, the Hohner clavinet. And I recently acquired a rare model which precedes the D6, which is the common brown one that you see everybody playing.
Okay.
But I acquired a C5, which is a red and white model. Sounds a little different from the common D6. And
cool.
It's just fantastic sounding. I got it on a new solo record. I'm hoping to use it even more.
Awesome.
But I get to be very, while it's not particularly rare or weird or eccentric like my synthesizers, it's an instrument that I just feel such a kinship with. it's the closest I get to be to a guitar player.
Okay.
With clavinet, because you get to put it through amplifiers and process it with effects like a guitar player and really turn it up and scream. I mean, I did that a lot in Imperial Drag.
Right, right.
Showcased that a lot. But yeah. Anyway, yeah.
Now, your studio, you still have your Stu studio, right?
No.
Oh, man, all right.
I lived in that house for 11 years, and my partner and I ended our relationship, and I moved on, which meant moving out of the house as well.
Okay.
And I live in a lovely new home with my fiance, Laurel. We're going to be married sometime in the immediate future. I'm very excited about that.
Wow, but, cool. Well, congratulations on that.
A lovely little house doesn't have any room for all of us here.
Right.
It's pretty much me and my computer and the occasional piece or two. Most of my stuff, unfortunately, is in storage right now.
Mm-hmm.
And I go and pull things out for sessions and different projects.
Okay.
I was definitely spoiled at the last place where I had most of it out on display, plugged in, and ready to make music.
Right. Okay. Well, so then that kind of brings me close to the end. Currently, what's a day in the life of Roger Joseph Manning Jr. like?
Every day is about making music or growing as a human being. What I mean by that is music has always been my kind of connection to spirituality.
For sure.
I'm not a churchgoer in any traditional sense, but I do believe that we are all something greater than these bodies, and that we are eternal, you know, spiritual, loving force. And I know that's real because music's real, and we've all been affected deeply by certain music and certain artists, and not so much by others. But it's that conveyance of the heart and soul through the energy of music. So I've been exploring as much my musical life, because that continues to grow. You know, my personal spiritual life, and just simply what I mean by that is doing a lot more reading, listening to lectures, simply for the goal of creating more peace in my life.
Very nice.
More tranquility.
Right, I hear you.
more love in all of its manifestations. And lo and behold, it filters back into my music. In fact, Catnip Dynamite has a lot of lyric writing that has been about my explorations in that area.
Cool.
Which is not what I set out to do. It just kind of flew out of me when I started putting pencil and paper. And then musically, it's all about keeping, you know, basically I stay creatively fulfilled, you know, and I enjoy making music and, you know, keep a comfortable, if not extravagant, and the living happening by having my hands in a variety of musical things. So, still freelance as a keyboard player here in Los Angeles and abroad. I play on people's things long distance, even that file transfers and stuff. So,
yeah. Awesome.
You know, tell your friends. I love doing that. and then more recently, I've been doing a lot more arranging of people's records, like string or orchestral arrangements.
Wow. Okay.
I'm on the albums from last year from Nate Lewis, from the band's Fun, producer Neil Haney on his solo record. Huge variety since Young the Giant, more albums 2 years ago.
Right.
I was playing, I just did a bunch of arranging on Jimmy Eat World.
All right.
Putting the album out.
Awesome.
So it's a variety of things where I get to just be an arranger. And, it's been lots and lots of fun because, of course, I did that in Jellyfish, but for a variety of reasons, I didn't pursue that a lot. And now I've been enjoying creating more and more of that work. In fact, I have a website for that, which is just called RogerArranging.com.
Okay, cool.
And it basically showcases what me and my partner do for that, as well as looking for some jobs to be involved with. Solo album in between those cracks, and then Beck, which is really a part-time job because he doesn't tour all year round. He doesn't record all year round. Just loving the variety of work. I've been really enjoying getting introduced to different communities that aren't just pop stuff. I'm on the new Heim record.
Wow, that's awesome.
I'm on the new Adele record.
Hmm.
So it's a lot of fun variety of things. Brandon Flowers from The Killers put out an album last year, which is really, really filled with keyboard stuff.
Cool.
A lot of my contribution, I think the songwriting he did, his voice is just brilliant. So it's been really great to get a chance to collaborate with all this huge variety of people.
Yeah.
And it just doesn't get old. I want more and more of that because it's really fulfilling.
Yeah, that sounds, sounds pretty amazing. Well, that's really it, Roger. Thanks. I hope you enjoyed the interview.
Yeah, always. I have no problem talking about myself for 45 minutes.
All right, good. Well, I mean, I tried to touch on everything mostly, you know?
Yeah, totally.
Anything you want to say before we put an exclamation point on this one?
No, really, just a big thank you to everybody who's listening and who's been so supportive and continues to take an interest in anything me and my former bandmates continue to do because it's really keeps it all going around for us. It makes it all worthwhile. And I can't tell you how many Beck shows I've played where some really great fans come up to me afterwards and reminded me how much those early records influenced them and inspired them. They're still listening to them. That just never gets old.
Right.
Just, one compliment a month, all I need for the rest of my life.
Well, it seems like you could probably get a little bit more than that, I'm sure, Roger. But, I mean, for me, especially for me, this is something that's like a dream come true, considering I was a little kid worshiping Jellyfish. And, I mean, I know you and I have almost kind of had like a somewhat distant relationship for almost like the past, I don't know, many, many years. Because we met at a Moog show in the city a long time ago. I mean, I wasn't even young enough to get in. I snuck in. And, then I worked for Music Pro, which we insured your gear, so we kind of chatted a bit every now and again. Now I do a lot of different stuff, which is really cool for me, too. And it's just amazing, Roger. I'm very, very happy that we can connect once in a while. You know, you're a musical hero and influence and everything, you know, beyond that. And I hope that we can still stay in touch, and I hope to maybe see you, you know, over the summer.
Absolutely. Hopefully you will.
So.
Sounds great.
But let me not keep you. Let me turn this off here and give me some time to get through this thing because this was a long one. This was good. You definitely got my work cut out for me on this one, Roger.
Right on. Okay, great. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you.
Great interview. Thanks again, Soda.
Thanks, Roger. I will email you soon. I'll keep you up to date with this thing and I'll get it out as soon as I can. And it's going to be awesome. I can't wait to spread this one around. Thank you so much.
Good talking to you.
All right, Roger, I'll speak to you soon. Thanks. Bye.
Bye.